Welcome everyone in this nation versus regional versus local memories session. It is not always easy to group papers around the same theme, as you probably know, in international conferences. The three papers in this session share the fact that they deal with monuments within a regional or a local context in relation to a broader national context, and hence the title of this session. I will give the floor now to the first speaker, Victoria Sukhovata from the Kharkiv National Karazin University in Ukraine will present a paper on city monuments in contemporary Kharkiv, construction of the national and regional memory. Victoria, you have the floor and you have 15 minutes for your lecture.
Hello everybody, and thank you for invitation to this conference. In my presentation, I plan to consider the phenomena of destruction of monument as political gesture in comparative dimension in the global context and in the local dimension. The first samples are from the history of destroying we have known from the textbook on ancient history, where the facts were given on the invasion of Roma by the barbarian tribes who destroyed the Roman buildings and monuments, which were symbols of the greatness of the Roman civilization. The radical destruction of monuments happened in revolutionary France in 1793. In 1733, France proclaimed freedom, equality, and brotherhood as the central idea of the new society. But in the context of this idea, the kings were overturned and even monuments of the kings were destroyed as signs of the old hatred regime. Destroying monuments and coffins cannot, of course, delete the memory of the past, but it was the political gesture of a new power, of a breach any link with the past. In 1917, one of the most radical revolutions happened in Russia with similar destroying of monuments. After the October Revolution of 1917, Bolshevik leaders in Russia almost completely repeated the practices of the French revolutionaries. They destroyed the churches in Russia, desecrated altars, killed the Tsar's family and many aristocrats, and they overthrew monuments to the former Russian emperors and their nobles. The emotional idea of this destroying was obvious. The destroying of monuments in the revolutionary society was a kind of psychoanalytic compensation for the former injustice and preparation for creation of a new world from the remains of the past. In other words, revolutionaries in this case wanted to be like a god from the point of view of creating a new world from nothing. However, I need to note that the fight against monuments that symbolize a certain political ideas started not in 20 or 21st century, and was not typical not only in the era of the Bolsheviks, but much earlier. I will give several details from the history of the city of Kharkiv, which can make clear the situation. Kharkiv was the second largest city in Ukraine in the 19th and 20th centuries, which was officially mentioned in the historical sources in 1654 as a military fortress, the inhabitants of which were Cossacks, who guarded the southern borders of Russian Empire from attacks by nomadic tribes. In the 19th century, Kharkiv was a center of the Slobodskoy Krai, located in the northeast of contemporary Ukraine, just 1 hour near the borders of contemporary Russia. So this geographical position impacted on the culture and regional mentality of the locals and the specificity of the Kharkiv history. The first known sample of the destruction of the Kharkiv monuments happened at the beginning of the 20th century, and it was not connected with the Bolshevik era. The history happened after establishing the monument to the Alexander Pushkin, the great Russian poet of the 19th century. Pushkin was in Kharkiv only once during his life, but he was the favorite poet of many Russian-speaking people, and in 1899, Kharkiv locals decided to install the bust of Pushkin in one of the central squares of the city, the Square of Poetry, by the sanctuary of the Pushkin birds. As the newspapers of that years wrote, this monument should be an evidence of the gratitude of Kharkiv residents to Pushkin as the creator of the modern Russian language and to the divine poetry. 5 months after the installation of the monument, activists of the group Defense of Ukraine, created on the initiative of the Ukrainian politician Nikolai Mikhnovsky, tried to blow up the monument to Pushkin. As a result of the explosion, the bust of Pushkin was mostly not damaged, but windows in the near houses were broken off. It was center of city. Mikhnovsky's motivation was as follows: a bust of a Russian poet must not stand in the Ukrainian city of Kharkiv before the installation of the monument to the great Ukrainian poet Taras Shevchenko. Another point of accusation against Pushkin was that Pushkin glorified the Russian Empire. Mikhnovsky, initiator of this destroying, led agitation among students and the Kharkiv intelligentsia for a revolutionary struggle for the rights of the Ukrainian people. He considered the explosion of the monument to Pushkin as a way to draw attention to the needs of Ukrainian independence. However, his arguments were not completely true. Poet Pushkin not only glorified the Russian Empire, but also criticized it. Pushkin was repressed many times for his ironical and freedom-loving verses by Russian authorities. The second point was, in fact, that the first bust of the great Ukrainian poet Shevchenko was established in Kharkiv even earlier than Pushkin in 1899, but it was placed not in the center of the city, and it was established on the private initiative of Kharkiv philanthropist Alchevsky, who placed the bust of Shevchenko near his own estate. So we can see that establishing of monuments to the poets in Kharkiv was used by some political movements and their representatives as a tool of struggle for the political influence in city. The most significant destroying of monuments happened in the former Russian Empire after the Bolshevik Revolution and during the Civil War of 1918-1933. Due to the fact that Kharkiv was not a capital as compared to St. Petersburg or Moscow, where there are not so many monuments in the city, and the main object of destruction were the Kharkiv churches. Many wonderful Orthodox churches were destroyed in the period of 1930s years. Also, one Lutheran church was destroyed, which was existed in Kharkiv, in old Kharkiv also, and one Islamic house also, which existed in Kharkiv in 19th century as well, because Kharkiv was city for more than 100 nationalities in 19th and 20th centuries. During the Soviet era, the state mostly decided that monuments and memorials should be present in the Soviet public space. Three groups of monuments dominated in the Soviet urban space from the October Revolution and until the beginning of the Nazi invasion in 1941. They were as follows: the monuments dedicated to the revolution, to the heroes of the Civil War, and to the heroes of the peaceful socialist labor, to Soviet workers, athletes, and peasants. During the Second World War, Kharkiv survived the horrible Nazi occupation when the thousands of locals were killed. Because Kharkiv was the first capital of the socialist Ukraine. Nazi considered Kharkiv as a very important center and try to rob all libraries and destroy monuments to Lenin and our socialist leaders. After liberation of Kharkiv from the Nazis by Red Army, due to several battles waged in the Kharkiv region, the graves of fallen soldiers and Soviet soldiers and officers were numerous, both individual and common. Many of them included nameless fighters, and today they are known and officially registered more than 63 war graves in the city of Kharkiv and more than 1,900 graves in the whole Kharkiv region, but many anonymous graves of the wartime continue to be discovered. Destroying the Soviet war memorials was impossible in the Soviet time, not only because it was led to punishment for demolishing the monuments, but because the majority of the Soviet people, especially people from the families who survived the Nazi occupation or struggle in the battles, considered such damage as an act of severe vandalism and immorality. After disintegration of the Soviet state, many Soviet memorials in Ukraine were destroyed, especially it happened with the ideological monuments which were devoted to the socialist leader. The regional situation in Kharkiv was more liberal. Only three monuments, socialist monuments in the center of city were deconstructed completely from 1991 to 2014. They were follows: the monument to the Soviet writer Maxim Gorky in Central Park, the monument to the Soviet writer Anton Makarenko, and the big, about 10 meters size, a monument in the center of city, which was established in honor of the proclamation of the Soviet power in Ukraine in Kharkiv in 1975. You can see it in picture. After independence of Ukraine, the monument in honor of the proclamation of the Soviet power in Ukraine was considered as unsuccessful artificially and was deconstructed. This monument was replaced by the new symbol of the city, the statue of Lion Mercury with wings, the Roman god of trade, communication, speech, and writing, who was considered by the city authorities as more corresponding with the new image of post-socialist Kharkiv as a dynamic trade developing city of science and students. The mass demolition of the socialist monument in Kharkiv happened after 2018 and the adaptation of the law on the decommunization of the Ukrainian public space. The ideological reason to break with the Soviet past was proclaimed in the case in Ukraine that meant that ideological fight against the past. The idea was that the visual presence of the Soviet socialist monuments in Ukrainian cities focuses attention on the past, and these monuments represent a physical connection with the Soviet past, and their demolition has to delete the public memory of the socialist era. During 2014-2015, about 100 monuments of Lenin were destroyed in Ukraine. This phenomenon was even called Leninopad, Lenin fall. As a result, were destroyed six monuments to Lenin in the different districts of Kharkiv, starting from the central monument, which started at Svoboda Square in the center of the city since 1963. This is central monument. There were several attempts to destroy this monument but many locals tried to protect them, mostly pensioners and different groups of people. However, on September 2014, a group of activists drew a crane, and for several hours they were breaking the monument in the presence of a crowd of people. A part of this process, in different districts of the city, about 20 socialist monuments to the leaders of the revolution were demolished. In particular, they were monuments to Lenin comrades, Яков Свердлов, Николай Руднев, Павел Постышев, Серго Орджоникидзе, Иван Котлов, Сергей Киров, revolutionary leader Artyom, and several other people. However, I want to say that as a result of demolishing, the cultural and semantic space in the Kharkiv city became more open, but not completely empty. And the Kharkiv authorities tried to put some new ideas in this new space, which was connected with pre-revolutionary memory of the Kharkiv or non-socialist memory of Kharkiv. For example, I can define more than 10 categories of the new memorials and sculpture groups in the today Kharkiv, which were erected by various cultural, professional, and religious communities of the city to restore justice toward regional history of the city, which was ignored in the socialist times. In particular, it was a large group of the monuments concerning the pre-revolutionary achievements of Kharkiv science, because Kharkiv was the big scientific center. But these images were not presented in Soviet public space. For example, they were the monuments to the outstanding Kharkiv doctor ophthalmologist, Leonard Girschman. You can see picture at screen. Who established the first eye hospital in Ukraine, and of course in Kharkiv. It was end of 19th and the beginning of 20th century. Even Bolsheviks after coming did not kill this professor and did not destroy his hospital. Another monuments were devoted to famous Kharkiv educator and philanthropist Alexei Alchevsky, who did much for development of education among Kharkiv middle class and poor people. To the academician of architecture Alexei Biketov, who created more 40 beautiful buildings in Kharkiv in the first part of the 20th century.
And Victoria, you need to conclude now.
And, yeah, I understand. One two sentence. Another group of the new erected monuments was devoted to outstanding scientists, for example, Nobel Prize winner Lev Landau. Also, there were monuments to Orthodox science who were absent in Kharkiv, and many musicians and singers, for example, like in this picture to Isaac Dunayevsky and Klavdia Shulzhenko, very popular actors whose images were absent in Kharkiv. And I can conclude very, very quickly, of course, that this situation to renovate urban space was a kind of attempt to make balance after the construction, balance of memories of different kind of memories of Kharkiv, after destroying of the monuments of past and constructing of new identity, regional identity of the city. Thank you for attention.
Thank you, Victoria. One question for you, Victoria. In your very first slide or second slide, you showed us the monument of Pushkin, late 19th century, if I well remember, but apparently also a modern photography of today. Does this mean that the statue of Pushkin survived all these regimes changes? And what was the graffiti on the statue? Could you respond
yes.
on that?
Yes, thank you for question. It's true. Pushkin monument was constructed in beginning of 20th century, but he survived. Pushkin survived, and monument survived the regime. It was damaged a little bit during Nazi era, but he was reconstructed in Soviet time, and now this monument exists mostly in similar place like in beginning of 20th century. But now some people try to make not destroying damage to this bust, and to write some anti-Russian slogans, because Pushkin was Russian speaker poet.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Thank you. There is another question of Jose Manuel. Jose, you have the floor.
Excuse me.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, Jose, go ahead.
Right. Thank you very much for this interesting paper. Victoria, I was wondering whether you could expand a little bit more on the local memory of the great patriotic war, in inverted commas, of the war against the Germans in Kharkiv, because as far as I know, this regionalized, this local memory of the war is very strong in Kharkiv, has some peculiarities, or it displays some peculiarities in relation to the Ukrainian pattern anyway, but also during Soviet times, Kharkiv had been awarded, if I'm not wrong, something like the title of heroic city by the Soviet government. To what extent is this still alive? And there is a proper local narrative about Kharkiv during the so-called Great Patriotic War, and how has it changed over the last 30 years since Ukraine is independent? Thank you very much.
Thank you for your question, Jose. Please, Victoria, a brief answer, because we have only a few minutes.
Yeah, I would like to say thank you much for this question, because it's very, very, very true and very important question. And I have a much longer presentation, and I shot for 2-3 papers today, and I wanted to say more about situation during the Second World War and Nazi occupation, because it's really very strong situation, a very strong impact on Kharkiv local identity and local memory. And if to be brief, now until today, the war memorials, which are continue to be in dozens, maybe about 100 in all Kharkiv and Kharkiv region, many, because there are several battles here. They are continue to be. They were not destroying after 1991 and the disintegration of the Soviet Union, because during Second World War, every Kharkiv family had a relative, minimum one relative, who struggled in the war and perished. And many people survived the occupation. For example, my grandmother survived occupation in Kharkiv, and many people reminded this horrible time. So, of course, it was strong regional identity, and this identity impacted on some level to contemporary situation in Kharkiv. Thank you much.
Thank you, Victoria, for this clarification.